The year is 1983. Where were you?
The video game market has crashed.
Some of these gentlemen were not even alive in 1983.
Yes, we were.
Well, some of these podcast gentlemen. Yeah. This man was not.
No,
you were not alive?
No.
Two more years.
No.
Two more years.
No. So these vivid recollections of 1983, we can't all talk about them as if we were there. But we certainly have been studying this subject for quite some time. And here we are on the 30-year anniversary.
30.
Oh, by the way, who decided that now is a 30-year? Is it just because of 2013? Or is it the holiday season? Or is it a specific date that someone came up with?
Or
I mean, why are we saying it?
Yeah, why are we? We decided it's 30-year anniversary. Let's talk about the crash.
I figured, why not?
Okay. All right. I thought maybe.
Oh, okay.
So maybe somebody posted on Twitter. Ah,
this was the
today
date.
Is the official day that we're living in.
Oh, no.
There's no meme for it. Never forget. Nothing like that.
But maybe we should start one.
Yeah, we should. You just get the box art of E.T. Never forget.
We have declared this day the 30-year anniversary.
I mean,
of the end.
I'll tell you.
Era.
You go on some of these classic game forums, and they still haven't gotten over the crash of '83. I mean, it is. It's
yeah.
Like, oh my God, what would have come out on the 5200 and the ColecoVision? What would have come out?
Yeah, well, I mean, they are coming out.
They're coming out anyway.
10 times better than what we saw back then. Well, for the most part. But, well, let's talk, let's give our educational background as we were not all actually there for. Let's talk about why we think there was a crash or what may or may not have been the real reasons behind Crash of 83. Who wants to start? Pick a topic, pick a reason. There's a lot of reasons why it happened. It was a perfect storm.
Well, I can talk about the point of view as someone who was not there for it, but grew up reading about it. And the most common cause of the crash was, of course, E3. But
E.T.?
I'm sorry.
E3 caused it?
Yes, it was E3, damn it. No, E.T. that's cited as the most common cause of it, but... the more specific explanation is not solely E.T. It was more a culmination of things that happened before it, but there were a lot of low-quality titles being released for the Atari all at once. The market was being flooded, and people just said, forget it, I'm not buying any of this crap anymore. That's what the more realistic explanation is given, and that's what I'm pretty sure of is the cause of it. But that's only as someone who wasn't there. That's all
I
can say.
You know, I think history both proves and disproves certain things over time. That one's definitely proven. There's no question that there was way too many games and way too many systems out in 1983. Way too much. And nobody knew what was good and bad.
Right.
So you had a guess. Pac-Man has to be a winner.
Right.
E.T. was a great movie. It has to be a winner.
Right.
You know, and you get burned enough times as a parent, and you start to say, I give up on this. You know, this isn't for me.
Right, especially if your kids are throwing away the games the next day because it sucks.
However, let's talk about the myths, if you want to call it, perhaps urban legend of E.T. and of Pac-Man for the 2600.
You mean E3.
E3. Which one did I say?
No, you said E.T.
All right. So, you know, the myth is that first Pac-Man came out first.
Yep.
And I believe the myth there was that so many copies were produced, more copies than there were 2600s available. And that was the famous Atari executive who literally came out and said, well, we think that everyone will love this game so much, they'll buy one for themselves at home and one for their ski lodge.
Right.
As if everyone has a ski lodge.
And that sounds like, was that a Ray Kassar statement?
No, it was some just like marketing VP. Yeah, it was some marketing VP.
Also, the cart is too heavy to bring with you, so gotta leave it in the house.
Well, I'm sure, and probably more realistically, if they felt that way, then overall they might have felt more like, this game is, people want it so much that they'll go buy a system.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, like, that happens even today.
Of course.
Pokemon comes out on the 3DS, people are buying 3DSs.
Yeah.
And
it's a system seller.
And let's be realistic. But they're actually over there.
Yeah, I forgot to grab them, but there's a couple. Yeah, we had a couple of visual aids.
Chop chop.
Oh boy. Vanna White here. So, the Pac-Man for the 2600 that actually came out sold a lot.
Let's face it. This was not a failure by Atari that it didn't sell. It sold a ton of them.
Not a commercial failure.
No. So, you know, it sold a ton. You know, I don't think we need to get into the fact that, some people hate the game. You know, I mean, I was a little kid. I got it probably around 84-ish. I had no problem with it. I liked it. You know, it wasn't like the arcade.
I liked it, too, to be honest with you.
That's what it is.
When it came out. But I also was disappointed.
Yeah.
It was a little of both.
Well, now, both of these games, what they have in common is they were both rush jobs by the Atari programmers to get them out there, basically.
And we never blame the programmers for that.
Right.
It was not their fault.
Yeah, the whip was cracked.
Todd Fry and Howard Scott Warshaw were good, very good programmers. And in their other work, we would see that that's the case. But given a very short time frame to make a holiday demand, both times, maybe not.
And Todd Fry gets, I think, unfairly criticized for that, plus people are like, well, he made all this money on Pac-Man. Well, yeah, because he negotiated a deal to say, you're going to pay me royalties if I make it or I'm leaving. I'll go to a different company. So that's, good
right.
on to
they
him
could
have to
gone
do
to
that.
Somebody else.
Yeah. So that's the myth of the 2600 Pac-Man, was that there was way too many sold and that killed the market. The other myth with E.T. was that there was way too many sold. This was true. It was way too many produced.
Right.
They produced way too many for E.T. It wasn't good. And they paid a ridiculous amount of money to Steven Spielberg for the license, which is probably the worst thing of all, really.
Well, for Atari, but not necessarily for the industry.
Right. So Time Warner, I think, still owned them at the time. They spent this huge amount of money on a movie they didn't even have the rights to. It's kind of odd.
Things were different.
Warner Brothers. Sorry, not Time Warner. Warner Brothers. They were still Warner Brothers then. And so, the myth, the urban legend is that Atari had so many leftover E.T. cartridges that they dumped them in a landfill. And to this day, people are still trying to dig them up. So that's kind of the treasure hunt aspect of the crash of 83, in a sense, for these games. All right, so we've established that there were too many big-name titles that were produced. We know that. We know that there were too many
games and systems in general.
Yeah, there was. Well, that was the thing. So there was too many unlicensed games because Atari had no control over it.
Right. There were no licensing things back then. Right. Anybody could jump in, and Quaker Oats could jump in and say, we're going to make games now, too. We're going to impress our shareholders by joining the electronic gaming market.
Well, they did sue Activision.
Check it out. We've got Space Jockey. We're going to produce a million copies, which I don't think they had quite the same problem selling them, believe it or not. They just happened to be jumping in at the right time.
Well, we'll get to why they were able to sell that many in a second. So there was also, as I was saying, unlicensed games. Now, Atari sued Activision right after they were first formed.
Right,
right.
Basically said, well, wait a minute. A, you cannot form a company. How dare you? And B, you cannot make games for our system. And I guess they lost.
They lost.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
So that didn't go anywhere.
That set the precedent.
Yeah. So now it's a free-for-all. Everybody's making games, like you were saying. And also, the other piece of it is the systems. So Atari, 2600 was out. Then there was the Intellivision. That had been out for a couple of years. And then all of a sudden, 82 was the ColecoVision and the Atari 5200. Coming out at the same time.
Now you're seeing new generations of game systems in the same, roughly the same period of time.
Yeah.
And the games weren't that different.
Well, I don't know about
in
that.
In a sense.
But it's just another option.
Yes.
So you have this super popular system that you're already playing, and now they've got another one for you, and do you get the new one or don't you? And
they were expensive!
Yeah.
The new systems were really expensive.
Real expensive.
Yeah.
And then there was all of these other sort of side. We don't hear a whole lot about Vectrex or Arcadia, Emerson Arcadia. Odyssey 2 had been out for a while. But all of these are floating around. Everyone's got these systems and trying to figure out exactly what games to buy. Yeah. And now I'm going to lead in with what I think was a really big cause, which is all part of it. Now computers become... Computers are not only now affordable, they play game cartridges, they play games... they hook up to your TV, and they become a reliable and cheap alternative to video game consoles. So you got the rise of Commodore, Atari, in the UK, the Spectrum.
Tandy.
Yeah.
Right, Tandy computers.
Yeah, and why get a computer and a video game console when the computer...
I can do everything on my home computer now. My Texas Instruments computer plays a better version of Burger Time than my Atari 2600.
Yeah.
So,
but not in television.
Maybe I don't need to buy Atari 2600 cartridges anymore. No, but I mean, you know, you could certainly put yourself in that mindset where you could say, well, yeah, like, I'm consolidating everything now. I don't need all of that.
And there were the converters. There were the adapters. So if you bought an Intellivision or a ColecoVision, you could get an adapter to play 2600 games. You didn't need your 2600 anymore, you know?
Which is crazy by today's standards, right? Like, this is something we always bring whenever we go to an exhibit. We always make sure that we've got a ColecoVision around, and sometimes we'll bring the expansion module. And when you approach somebody in this day and age and you go, imagine Microsoft making a device that lets you play PlayStation games on an Xbox. That's what this is. That you were allowed to do it.
Yeah.
Or it was freely available. You can walk into a store and say, give me that thing. I want to play Xbox games on my PlayStation.
I'd like the Playbox adapter.
Or here's one better.
It's a crazy Wild West.
Here was one better. Coleco made a 2600 clone called the Gemini. They made
the entire console.
An entire system of their competitor. So that would be like Microsoft making a PS4.
Yep.
There were no intellectual property laws back then.
Well, there was, but I think you know why that they were able to get away with it.
Why were they able to get away
with it? Well, the off-the-shelf parts, and
Yeah, they were just buying all the components and putting it together.
There was nothing, in a sense, there was nothing proprietary because they didn't design anything proprietary. It was all readily available pieces, basically.
Well, and you know, the industry in general was so... I don't want to say cannibalistic, but they stole, you know, so companies were constantly stealing programmers and everybody from all the way around.
Yeah.
So Intellivision guys were going to Atari guys over there, right? The whole M Network group, I think, were guys that they had stolen from Mattel to be, you know, to. So it's like this giant pool of information. So it was really hard to have proprietary anything.
Yeah.
At the time.
Yeah. Well,
so
there was,
part of the license.
There was also no precedent for stuff like that back then. Like, I don't really think people were thinking about copyright of software. You know, even to this day, there's arguments.
Well, you couldn't copyright it.
Right. Even to this day, there's still arguments about copywriting software. So I guess that's another thing that you could make a... Like the Pac-Man clone arcade machines, you know, that Namco tried to sue.
Yep.
There wasn't really a precedent for it back then.
However, there was, in a sense, there was a case. I forget, was it maybe in Space Invaders where there was actual court case, federal court, and that was where they actually defined at that time that somebody had made a clone. I think it was of Space Invaders. I'm not sure, but it was a big game. Somebody came out with one of the many clones. They sued, and they said, "Well, you can't have that. This is our game." And then they said, "Well, but it's code, and you can." You can copyright the intellectual property, so I can't go out and make a Donkey Kong without Nintendo's okay, for instance. But you can copyright the code. I can't go out and steal their code and rewrite it in that way. But if you can reverse engineer it and design the code your own way from scratch and show that we didn't steal the code and we didn't steal the intellectual property, you get away with it.
Yep.
Yeah.
And that's why it was available.
Completely fair.
Whereas today, when you think about it, almost all the games, they're all sharing engines and things like that. So they are really stealing the gameplay aspect. It's all based today on intellectual property.
Right.
So you can't steal that.
Yeah.
But back then there was no.
You can steal mechanics.
Do whatever you want.
Yeah, you can steal mechanics like QuickTime events and things like that.
Right.
Yeah.
Now I had another thought. On the reason for the crash, and this is somewhat of a financial reason, for a couple of reasons. I think first you had a lot of these third-party companies that sprung up doing software, like Activision and Imagic. One of my favorites ever is Imagic, and all those, and they all went, they were almost all gone after the crash. And one of the reasons was there was this glutton, you know, just too many, there was too much out there, and they killed their margins, and they all had to undercut each other and that kind of thing. And they all died off because they didn't have capital and reserve. They were all startups. So once they ran through that, they had nothing left, and they're all dead. So you have the crash in the sense of there's too much on the market, and people just shut off and say, we're not buying any more of this crap anymore. And that hurt everybody, and those companies weren't able to survive. And then on the flip side, you say, well, why didn't, you know, what happened in television? You know, Mattel, what happened to ColecoVision? These were some big companies. But in reality, they were toy companies. And the way the toy companies thought was, this is a toy.
Yep.
So, like, I'll give an example. Hasbro came out with the G.I. Joe, A Real American Hero, around that time. And that lasted a couple of years. And then, they went in different phases of it. But most toys in those days would last, like, 2 years, 3 years. They would go through a couple of series and then retire the toy. Maybe bring it back in 4, 5, 6 years or something like that. But that's how the toy companies thought. Well, you know, hey, Mattel's looking at, well, this is television, we're not making money anymore. It's done. It's over. It's a fad. It's over with. It's gone. And they shut it down. And Coleco, you know, they were in worse financial shape. They had to shut it down. And so now, and then Atari, just for the history's sake, they were owned by Warner Brothers, a movie studio, and they were kind of the same way. Well, you know, we're not making money. We're losing money. Shut them down. And so that's kind of the reason we have the crash, and that's the reason why they call it the crash, in the sense that it killed almost everybody off, at least from a Western U.S. perspective. And that's it.
Yeah, corporate thinking.
Well, that's it.
Yeah.
You know, that everybody had sold out in some sense, because you needed, you know, when Nolan Bushnell came up with, when he created Atari, he didn't own it himself for very long, right? It was a few years, really.
Oh, how long was he there?
No, but how long before he sold it to, I guess it was, sold it to Warner Brothers, but whoever he sold it to first, he needed money. He didn't have a choice.
Right.
I remember he said that. He said, we can't produce the 2600 without capital. We have to have capital to be able to purchase the hardware and pay the hardware companies to make this stuff so we can sell the systems. And they couldn't do it on their own. And so they're forced to you know, bring in the corporations, and that's in a sense what eventually did them in.
Now, when all of these other companies started making games for the Atari, they didn't have to pay royalties to Atari back then, right?
No.
Just because they just came on and made the games, and they were reaping 100% of the profits.
Yeah, and that was Atari's suit against Activision.
Yeah.
You know, you're not allowed to do that, but they were.
I guess you could probably consider that a contributing factor to Atari's demise, is that a lot of people were making money off of their console,
right,
and they weren't seeing any royalties from software at all.
Well, their own games.
Right. Well, aside from their own games that they made, but,
yeah,
you know, that would never happen today. Like, you couldn't just make a game for the Xbox and not give anything to Microsoft.
You could. I think you could technically, but...
Yeah, well, they're smarter about it now, that's for sure.
Well, Nintendo, when the NES came out, it had the lockout chip.
Right.
That was the whole thing.
Right.
But there were still unlicensed companies. I mean, frankly, one of them was Atari.
But that's what kind of began the whole thing. I mean,
yeah,
Nintendo was smart about it. They're like, this is not going to happen to us. You know, we'll make sure everything has to come through our doors before it's out. So they prevented the whole, you know, glut of games being out there, and they had some control over the quality of the games. And,
well, that's... some people debate that.
It's easy to debate.
You
believe
still have
me,
to
we
get
have
a
whole topic about that.
Yeah.
But at least, you know, they kind of put some filters and rules in place to prevent 83 from happening anytime soon.
And they were sued for doing a lot of that
lost. Yeah. Well, you know, so you're either the bad guy because you're ruining the industry, or you're the bad guy because you're forming the industry.
Yeah.
You know, it doesn't matter.
It's a monopoly.
You know. Whatever you do, you know.
I think the biggest thing for Nintendo in terms of... coming out with their product and not getting killed was...
Go ahead.
Sorry.
Who is this man? Was the biggest reason was they actually... This is a FYI if you didn't know this, but NES, if you ever had or have now a gray NES typical cartridge, that was manufactured by Nintendo. They manufactured every single licensed game throughout the life of the system. So if you were Konami or if you were Capcom or unfortunately Acclaim or even worse LJN, if you were one of those companies as a third party, the only way you could get your games made was to pay Nintendo to manufacture your games, which made them a lot of money, but it also allowed them to control what was happening.
And we're probably drifting too far
yes.
into history.
Yes,
but we are definitely. But it's true. It's a stark contrast to what happened. So it got corrected, you know, and there was a couple of years in there where there was nothing going on here in the U.S. other than computers.
No.
No, come on through.
Sorry.
So really, the video game market didn't so much crash as it temporarily shifted to computers.
Because so the video game market definitely
crashed.
Because many, like Greg was saying, many of those companies just shut down their video game divisions.
Right.
Closed. And companies that were known for doing game systems like Coleco and GCE, they're gone. They stopped doing it altogether. Companies that had vested interest in multiple types of platforms, like Activision, that were still doing computer games, were able to stay afloat because they had computer games.
Barely.
And as a gamer, I suppose you could say, well, yeah, I just shifted over. I did. I went right from ColecoVision to Commodore 64. It was seamless to me.
Right.
Like I sometimes think back to it and I'm like, I mean, I guess there was a crash, but to me it just seemed like a shift in where I was playing my games.
Yeah.
It just went to a different system.
So it just felt like a natural evolution for
it
you.
It did. It did. But I think the gaming aspect of it suffered tremendously. And many, many people lost their jobs, and lots of companies that probably would have been cool to have around today, you know, couldn't.
Right.
I mean, when you think about it, other than from computer, which was mostly new game development people, just came out of the woodwork doing computer titles, other than those folks, all of the people, when I say people, all the programmers... And as you know, you've met so many over the years, how many of these guys who were such good programmers in the early 80s, and after the crash, they just stopped. They like became accountants or lawyers. They went into some other realm and like never did another video game. That's one of the, I think, the tragedies is that all these great programmers, Western, especially U.S. programmers, just overnight, they're just gone.
Yeah.
We lost them. It was like we lost like a generation of them. And that's why, like, when, again, not to get ahead, but when the NES and all the Japanese systems came in and took over, it was all Japanese programmers because, you know, they kept going. There was no video game crash in Japan.
No, and it's interesting when you look at the pack, even of U.S. developers, look at the pack of U.S. developers that were producing games for the Nintendo, only a year and a half after this crash, were all different guys than the guys that dropped out in 83. So... With some exceptions. I mean, I can name a few. Steve Wojda, for example, hung around.
David Crane.
Yeah, Crane. Crane did NES and Super NES and Genesis games. But even that was kind of limited compared to what he was doing before.
Yeah.
So it's amazing that all of that whole generation of programmers, like you say, just kind of went on to do other things. Now, and a lot of them, it's funny, a lot of them have come back over the years to do... Because iOS becomes a very viable option for guys that know how to do that kind of thing, where they can sort of tinker with it, and there's lots of tools.
Right.
And you know, we've seen the resurgence of a lot of those guys. We saw who do we have? Robert Yeager here with Montezuma's Revenge. He was a visitor at the store not long ago with a new Montezuma's Revenge on an iOS platform. So you know, they're still around doing it, but that's not what he does.
No,
yeah,
you know,
yeah,
so they're hobbyists that which you know is definitely a shame.
Yeah,
they're kind of back where they started on the fringe.
Yeah.
And I think that's why they do it, because it kind of feels like then. Like, it feels like those days where they could get behind it themselves.
Yeah.
It was their project. They did the sound and the graphics and the manual and everything else. And,
yeah.
you know, there's some appeal to that for those guys.
Yeah, and there's no producer telling you, no, you have to do this in this time frame.
And you better get it out by Christmas.
4 weeks!
Yeah, I mean, it. You know, we lost a lot of that, and but one thing I was going to ask was your perspective as you were buying games at the time. That almost overnight, right? It was like all of a sudden games were $60. New games, you know, new Atari game was $60. That this is 30 years ago, $60, And overnight, everything was like $10, $5.
Oh, better.
Yeah.
Better. So, and, you know, $60 gets thrown around a lot, but I, the way I remember it was more, games more in that Atari generation were more like $40.
All right.
All
right. And they bumped up to 60 somewhere between the NES and the Genesis, because what I remember most of all was like games, $60 games were like Madden. Like the first time I saw a $60 game was like the first time I bought a Madden game. Like, oh, why? I must have it, and it's $60. There may have been some, and maybe in different places in the country.
But they were full retail.
Full retail game. Yeah. And you know, I can vividly remember before I was even driving, hopping on the bus and going to the Wayne Hills Mall where we had a Child World. And Child World, I bought Pac-Man the day it came out. I remember buying Yars' Revenge the day it came out. And I'm pretty sure that those games were $40.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
And then by like...
hard-earned money went to buy a $40 Pac-Man.
And by, let's say, summer of 84, they were
$4? And this is why I remember it so clearly, because by that time I was driving... Mm-hmm. And my friend Kevin and I would hit all of the game stores and like shopping centers and grab everything, because for a good 6 months, it seemed like all the things that used to be up there, either behind glass or on hooks or behind a counter that I couldn't touch, were now sitting in a giant metal bin or on these shelves just tucked away waiting for somebody to buy, and they were at tremendously discounted prices. Yeah. Are we good time-wise? And
wow. So now let me ask you, back then when you were buying all of these ridiculously discounted games, did you have it, were you already collecting, I guess you would say? Was that in your mind, like, I want to grab all these now because I might never see them again?
Yeah, I mean, I may be very unique in that way. I think I have a sort of a mental problem when it comes to that, but I always was. I was a collector since the day I was born. Like, I collected anything I got my hands on that I was interested in. But what I didn't do... is I didn't over-collect. Like, I didn't buy two or three or 10. Look, there's Atari 2600 Springer in the box for $1.99. I should buy 10 of them because they might be... I never thought...
Right, the thought didn't occur to you.
Never thought about
it. Well, how could it?
No.
Yeah.
At most, I would buy two because one of them was for Kevin. Yeah, one was for my buddy and one was for me. But I never had more than one of anything when I bought them. And I'm telling you, that Springer specifically in my head, I remember staring at that bin, that giant bin, and seeing Springer, 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 Springer. And I swear maybe River Patrol was in there, and I didn't get that one because I'm like, I'd rather have, I don't know, probably something not worth anything at all. You know, there were, I remember being tons of Spectrovision games too, like the Planet Patrol was tons of Planet Patrols. I probably got Planet Patrol's awesome. I'm gonna get two of those. And zero River Patrols. Ooh, that was a big mistake. But, you know, I will say that I guarantee that I picked up everything that was cheap at the time.
There you go.
And it was a good... It went on for a good 4 to 6 months, I think, where stores like... KB Toys was great for that. Toys R Us was great for that. Toys R Us had tons of Intellivision stuff. All those INTV titles that came along later. Mm-hmm. I got everything that I had for Intellivision, I got from them.
They were... I remember the Toys R Us were still selling, and KB and those at Radio Shack, they were still selling, like, bargain bin, $5, new unopened Atari 2600 games. Not the other, like, Air, you know, River Raid and, you know, Defender, regular games... Probably through like the late 80s, I remember seeing them. I mean, there was just stock and stock and stock. Never get rid of the stock.
Because, you know, it didn't really... I don't think they got rid of all that stuff. And there were still games coming out. Because Atari came back again and started putting them out. And they're like, well, they've got, you know, let's grab that stuff out of storage and put it back out.
Well, there was no one to send it back to at a certain point, right? I mean,
well...
I don't think they took it back.
I guess not. I guess not. Because it seemed like they would sell it at any cost,
right?
As long as
they can get it out of there.
I miss those days. I really do.
Now, do you still have everything that you bought back then?
Oh, definitely.
Yeah,
definitely. I've never been one to resell, you know, my own personal collection. In fact, when I opened the store, a lot of the things that I brought here as inventory, I bought. Like, they weren't even from my collection, because I was always concerned, like, well, what if I can't get it again? Am I gonna put these rare 2600 games out for sale to fill up a shelf? What if they never turn up again?
Right.
I'll regret it forever. And working here for 8 years, I'm very glad that I did that, because I see many, many customers that regret it forever that they did it.
Yeah.
Sorry that they sold it, whether it be to me or to somebody that they, you know, tell me about from their past.
Yeah, it happens.
I regretted when I traded away, you know, not trade, but, you know, traded into, like, Funko Land and all my entire Genesis stuff, a lot of Super Nintendo things and NES things, and now I have them again.
I'm surprised, because I always think we're collectors. We know better, and we always knew.
Well, no, because
at some point it clicked on, like, no, uh-oh. Because
I was a kid then, and I needed, if I wanted a new game, like if I wanted an N64 game, I had to trade in some of my NES.
I think that's probably the biggest difference. There was no video game
that did not
exist.
Yeah. No,
that didn't happen.
Well, I never, like, I can tell you from myself growing up, I never wanted to trade anything in because, and it wasn't so much like, oh, I don't know if I'm ever going to get this again. It was more of, I don't know when I'm going to want to play this again. So even though I haven't played it in months, I know I'm going to get
you
that.
You knew
itch.
You were going to get those nostalgic trips,
right,
where you had to go back.
And I didn't have an allowance. Like I didn't have any. There were no chores for me growing up that I could. Oh, I'd do this and get money. So everything that I had as a video game was what my dad got me. So if I did trade something in, I would never be able to replace it. So I made sure I just kept everything that came my way, and a good amount of rare titles that I have are from that.
So rest in peace to the video game history of
the
old.
Second generation, fare thee well. We loved you.
Maybe we'll be talking about the crash of 2014 30 years from
yes,
now.
Yes, or maybe next year.
Yes.
All right, we're good.
Ready?
All right, so here's a little segment we like to call. I would say that. We don't actually have titles for these segments.
No titles.
Show and tell.
Yeah, there you go.
Show and tell. Well, Greg brought something very special to show.
It's in the digital form.
It's
so
what
I'll
is it?
I'll segue.
Segue when we're done.
No, I'll do it now.
All right.
So about a month ago, Rob, where is Rob? The mystery Rob, cast member.
Rob.
Yes, Rob and I. We went to the Chiller Theater Expo in Parsippany, New Jersey. It is a kind of like a has-been celebrity convention.
Well, it's like a B-movie horror type theme.
No, there's some mainstream people. You know, the Ralph Macchios and the Corey Feldmans of the world were there.
The mainstream Corey Feldman.
So, so they were there. And also, James Rolfe, the angry video game nerd, was also there. Along with his friend Mike and the Kyle Justin, you know, the theme
musician.
Song guy. Yeah. So they were there, and they were signing their stuff there, and James was kind enough to give us like a 5 minute or so interview for the podcast.
A video exclusive.
Yes.
Right? It is a video
That's
exclusive.
What it is.
He didn't really have anything to promote exactly at the moment, but you know, I figured since he was there, I might as well talk to him.
So that's your show and tell, which we'll put on immediately after this very quick show and tell segment.
And I had one other little story. While Rob and I were there, we one of the people that we met and got an autograph picture with was Terry Farrell from Star Trek Deep Space Nine, Back to School, a number of other things. She was on Becker for a few seasons.
Really?
Ted Danson, yes.
Oh. Did not know that.
They replaced her with Nancy Travis.
Fun fact.
Something like that. Anyway, so she was there, and she has like a 9-year-old son or something like that, and we were wearing our digital press t-shirts because we were intending on interviewing the James Rolfe, and she saw it, and she's like, are you guys gamers? And we're looking like, oh, yeah, yeah. And then we went this whole conversation with her about video games and that she played the Game Boy when she was... Apparently her favorite game back in the day when... was on the Game Boy was one of the Simpson games.
Like one of the Bart
Treehouse
games.
Of Terror?
Yeah, one of the,
which, I, the way she
Escape
just...
Escape from Camp Nightmare? Is that one of them?
Whatever they are, that's their acclaim, you know, turds. But,
hey!
They were passable.
No, they weren't.
Yes, they were. They were okay.
Some of them were. I don't know about the Game Boy ones.
Yeah, I'm not sure. But...
So the way she described it, she said it was very difficult and it took her forever to beat it. And I didn't have the heart to tell her, well, that wasn't because the game was difficult. It was because the game was crappy. That's why it took so long for you to beat it. It's bad.
If only you had picked up Mario or Tetris.
It would have
been a whole different experience.
I don't know. Maybe she did. But she said that her son loves watching the video game podcasts that do, like, the what do they call it? Like, the play-along ones? The people that they just, like... It's them recording footage from a game,
like,
and
the
they're
Let's
talking.
Plays.
Yeah, the Let's Play stuff. Yeah. But I did give her all the information for the Digital Press podcast, so it is possible that she has watched us.
So
she
might be watching. We might have right a celebrity now. Viewer.
Yes, could be. Yeah.
So of the 9 hits we get, one may be Terry Farrell.
There we go.
And one may be James Rolfe.
True.
Three of us.
Well, and James,
we're going to end up in double digits. We're going to end up in double digits soon.
Yes.
Well, that's pretty cool.
Thanks.
So I was hoping that she saw the Digital Press shirt and she's like, Digital Press! Oh, I love that story. You guys are great. I read all your books. Your fanzine. I still subscribe. When's the next issue? No.
I'm sorry. Sorry to have to break it to you.
It's all right.
Baby steps.
That's all right. All right. So I did bring a real physical show. All right. It's not cooler than what you got, but it's pretty cool. All right, again, camera from far away on a crappy camera, probably not going to have quite the same effect. But what this is it's a box that says Commavid on it, CM009, and it's an actual case that a retailer would have gotten when they received 6 of a Commavid game, which is an Atari 2600 third-party company. And inside the box, so you won't be able to see it, are 6 different Commavid titles that are boxed. Now, what's the significance of this? Well, Commavid games are fairly rare as it starts out. The one game that's on here on the bottom is Video Life, which it rumored to have 20 or less of those ever made, and I'm going to talk about that for a second. And maybe also interesting in here, there is a Cosmic Swarm box, which, again, not on this camera is it going to really do it justice, but this particular box is not the way you would have seen the game in a retail place. Now, and I'm just noticing now that on the back it's PAL and CCAM.
Yeah.
So, and I think I now remember that story that they had originally planned to do some licensing and distribution overseas. That never really happened. And the boxes themselves were created in very limited quantity. Why do I have this, and why is it a show and tell? It's not exactly a find, but sometimes in my line of work, I have access to things that you wouldn't normally find in the wild. One of those was, this was probably 12 years ago now, when John, Sean, and I, the museum guys, went to see the Commavid guys that are out in the Chicago area. Now, Sean lives out there. We gotten in touch with them, and John and Sean specifically wanted to buy the rights to Commavid. They wanted to buy whatever properties they had left. They wanted to buy the name and have whatever happens to Commavid basically be a video game history museum, which at the time was just John and Sean and their own, you know, personal enterprise, and these guys agreed to do it. So that week that we were all together, we hopped in the car and we went to see all 3 of them individually. And it was an interesting experience. You know, 2 of the guys we got into their homes to see their homes. They actually shared with us, you know, the little pile of things that they had still from their Commavid days. It's an interesting story with them in general. There were 3 guys that were very high tech people that just were interested in the hobby. And thought we could do this too. Everyone else is doing it. I think we could
literally.
Do it. Yeah, literally, yeah. Everyone was doing it. So they got together and they bought some equipment. A lot of the stuff that they did was done extremely ad hoc. Mm-hmm. They did a lot of their own, what's the word for retro or backwards retrofitting?
Reverse engineering.
Reverse, right. So they kind of reverse engineered how the Atari 2600 program would go by using various things, one of which I thought was interesting, was TRS-80 computer.
Do they, because the 2600 was, like, mostly off-the-shelf parts, so do they, like, assemble?
I don't think you needed to.
I don't know how that would work, like, if you were trying to program for one without.
Are you saying that they took a game, another Atari game, and reverse-engineered it?
They learned how to do the programming for the Atari by reverse engineering hardware and software.
All right. Okay. And then both.
Yeah, and some of those things are now part of the museum. Some of those pieces that they had were like their very first computer that they used to do the, you know, the design. And that's the reason why we do know for a fact that Video Life, while it had been rumored for a long time to be in very limited quantities, we discovered while we were out there that there were less than 20 of them made. It was only available through mail order. It wasn't popular. It was expensive, even through the mail order. And I think a lot of people were like, eh, do I really want that? You know, so they didn't make many. And the box for it, again, when you got the game in the mail, you didn't get that box.
You had to order it separately?
No. It was never available. Okay. So the box didn't, I don't think anybody ever saw that box until we finally showed up with them. And we had a few of them. We sold a few of them. But there were very few of those, too. It's not like there was a warehouse of Video Life boxes. Mm-hmm. These guys had them made, I guess, anticipating maybe a little bit of overflow or demand, you know, later on, and it never came, so boxes were not distributed.
So this is like straight up the most mom and pop kind of like basement like operation.
Absolutely.
Like just guys get together, let's do this.
Yeah.
Or for us. We're gonna do it for us kind of thing.
But you know, not that we're not smart guys, but these are guys that were very into engineering and you know, one of the guys is a doctor and they're scientist minds, you know, that basically, you know, wanted to tackle both the scientific and also the enterprise of it all, which is interesting because you always associate people who are that technical minded as not being very good at doing games.
Or business sometimes.
Really, maybe that too, but I think one or two of those guys had a little bit of savvy in that department.
How did they run the operation in terms of the mail order?
I don't remember. Yeah. I don't remember. It was a while ago. Yeah. There is a story. There's an archived story on the Digital Press website about that trip. I had photographs. I think we released a couple of ROMs that were partially completed games at the time. I seem to remember some Frog. It might have been called Frog, or it was Frog Chase or something. It was extremely undeveloped. The following year, we released at Classic Gaming Expo, we released Rush Hour, which was a game that hadn't really come out, and it was really buggy. We had somebody go in and sort of fix some of the bugs just so it was even playable. But I, you know, I always think it's kind of interesting that it's so hard to find. Like, it's, you know, people think about the holy grails of gaming. You would never think, oh, a box of Commavid games. But to me, like in my collection, this is the one thing that if there was a fire, yeah, I'd probably run in and save it. This is worth way more to me than a Nintendo World Championship coin.
Yeah.
You know, because
it's one of
I'm
a kind.
Only one of three people, I think, that has this whole set.
Yeah.
Quite as it is. So it's.
And I guess it's probably, you know, because the story is like a personal kind of thing.
Yeah, and I was there. Yeah, absolutely.
If you know the guys.
It's cool. We met them. And John and Sean do actually now own the Commavid license. So we've
That's
talked
cool.
about it over the years. Like, do we release, you know, the next homebrew game that comes out? Do we publish it as a Commavid game?
That would be really neat.
I always thought it was really cool, but they didn't really think it was that cool. So one out of three votes doesn't win. So it's never really happened. I think anytime we've ever published a game, even some of those, you know, games that we discovered, like Save the Whales or Pickup, that we released them under the original branding.
Right.
So if there were 20th Century Fox games like those two.
Well, I mean, that's normally what happens when somebody finds a prototype and they don't, you know, hoard it, if you want to say, and they actually release it. They usually just release it as it would have looked
right
back in the day, because that's what people want. You know, they want the nostalgia effect. They don't. You know,
if there was a good homebrew? Like, what if you
were
one of the three people,
the
and a new
different.
Game comes out, and you're like, you know what? That's a good. I believe in that game. Do you think it disrupts that company's legacy by putting a game out 30 years later and saying this is a Commavid title?
Well, there's a difference. First of all, it wouldn't be homebrew. It would be a prototype, like a beta, unreleased beta. Then I think you're allowed to say, all right, well, Atari was working on this unreleased game, you know, came out, somebody found it, and then they put it out there, or made a cartridge, whatever.
Well, you're talking about like a brand new game.
No, I'm talking about, somebody creates a brand new game.
I see, and then put it on
out on the
Commavid. If that were released as a Commavid title.
I mean, if you own the company, I mean, that's legit. I mean, there's nothing shady about that, nothing.
But
really,
as a gamer, how do you feel about it?
I don't think it bothers me. I mean, things like that happen fairly
honestly,
often. I mean, in terms of releasing things like
but under the original label, that's what he's saying, the original label.
Right, so imagine, you know, you are sitting in your room and you come up with this great idea for, you know, maybe it's a Minds of Minos sequel. And you say, you know, I want this to be a Commavid release. and we create a new box for you, and it's got, it looks just like this, and it's Mike Rosamilia designed, and the cartridge looks like, but it's published in 2014. Is that, does that disrupt the legacy?
I think if it's a sequel, it's okay, because you're still using their original idea. But if it's like, if you just come up with a game and call it like, I don't know, Wall Ball or something, some lousy sports game, you know, and then just say, well, here's Commavid. I don't know if that's...
I think that in terms of like yeah, if I were going to do it and call it a Commavid game, then no, because I don't have anything to do with Commavid. But if you guys are who now pretty much are Commavid, decide, you know, we're going to do this.
Yeah, but
I mean, that's
take a modern example. Take Activision. There is no one currently employed or with any stake in Activision who had anything to do with the original.
Or product. Atari, same kind of thing. Nothing. You know, the Atari branding. You know?
I mean, that's even.
Well, I mean, it's like. I mean that's really how
that's changed hands so many times.
Yeah, but that's how you know companies work. You know they you know.
I think
Walt ain't running Disney anymore. You know.
No. It's like, I mean, I think that you would be. I think you would have a little bit more sanction in doing that because you would be releasing it for the Atari 2600, which was the original system that they were releasing games for. It's not like you're coming out and releasing an iOS game and saying, "Well, this game is by Commavid." And people are like, well, who's that? You know, what's the point? Might as well just do digital press at that point.
I mean, unless you really want to, so, something like that. The only point of doing that is if you really wanted to cause like a resurgence in the name. Like you wanted, like, you're not really going to be able, you're not going to release something on the iOS and use Commavid as, like, you're not going to.
Not likely.
Yeah, so, I mean, the only point of doing that is if you wanted to turn Commavid into something else, you know. Like something taken in a different direction.
So I had this thought, just thinking to myself, how much was, forget about the versions you have, which are obviously very rare because they never really came out or anything, but if how much are one of those actual games retail, how much are those worth now? Just randomly. Just the cartridge,
just
say.
Loose cartridges. Yeah.
Commavid game.
Minds of Minos and Room of Doom are not particularly rare, they're uncommon titles, but those probably are now between $20 and $30 a piece, loose. Cosmic Swarm is probably in that same ballpark, right. I would think. Now, Cakewalk and Stronghold were later for them, and they're hard to find. People look for those.
So I'm thinking
a couple $100 each, I would think.
It's almost like those. Obviously you can't do it now, but if you had a time machine in some sense, you can go back in time. And you could actually create, even if it was a bad game, because a lot of these 2600 third-party games, they're bad. So if you could just make a bad game and just, like, throw it into, you know, a warehouse somewhere for 20 years, but release some at the time so that they're very, very rare and people know that they were actually produced in the lifespan of the system, then hold on to them for, like, 20 years and then start, like, trickling them out.
Yeah.
Sealed. This is sealed. How much point? Those games go for?
Like would you do it? Like if you had the time machine, would you do it?
$10,000.
If I'm going back in time, yeah, there's what I'm gonna.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, it's like George Costanza, petty thing to do. You know?
I know what you're saying.
No, I'm saying in hindsight, like we've missed the boat on all of these. Like you couldn't do it now on one of the common systems now because it's like There's so many games that are made, and I don't think people care about rarity.
The 2600 is in a league of its own because it was such a free-for-all. You know, nowadays, ever since, like, the NES, stuff like that, things like licensing schemes.
Well, there's NES games that are very rare.
There are, but it's a little different in terms of, like, you know, in terms of homebrew.
It wasn't the Wild West.
That's what most of these Atari games are. They're just homebrew.
Well, they're unlicensed.
At a time. Yeah. Like, I mean, people make homebrew games now. It just so happened those were homebrew games made at a time when it wasn't common.
More or less.
You know. Or, conversely, think about if you made one of the... where there was far more unlicensed, you know, out of the... Here they come out of the woodwork kind of games for computer systems back then. Atari and Commodore and TI 99 and everything. And to make one of those games, all you needed was like a floppy disk with a sticker on it. And they used to... They have like a printed out manual, one page, and put it in a plastic bag.
No money was spent in packaging.
Yeah.
Many of those.
Are those worth? I can't imagine those are worth that much.
They're not.
But those are, you know, those should, and when you almost think about it, they should be like almost like a Honus Wagner type of a collectible because they were the start.
It's hard to
predict. They're very rare.
It's just hard to predict. I mean,
but nobody wants them.
The market's fickle like that. People just sort of latch on to the thing that they find interesting, and then other people latch on to it because it's there. So you end up with something like, you know, like what makes Air Rage so interesting? You know, it's like it's just another one of those mom and pop operations that came out.
Right, but I'm saying
this is just how it is.
But I'm saying if you forget about if you had it then, if today you rummage through something and you say, "Oh, I found this. It's a prototype disc." Mm-hmm. Okay, and it has a game that never came out for on a computer or something on a disc. I think you'll get money for it, no question. There'll be a collector that wants it. But you'll get far less than if you found a prototype, not even a cartridge, but just a PCB board. Right?
Probably because the duplication is so much harder. Like, I mean, something like prototypes on CD are worth a hell of a lot less than on a cartridge.
But think about it's the same thing, right?
Oh, no, I know what you're saying. It's
there's
exactly
one
the same
of them.
Thing.
Yeah, but there's less demand. Yeah.
That's my point. Yeah.
There's nobody's looking for those.
For whatever the reason, we collect the cartridge games. But it's like nobody ever really cared to collect computer games. For whatever the reason.
Yeah, you know.
It's just one of those things.
Maybe because there were so many different computers and many different variations of those computers and an evolution of computers over the years.
Yeah.
I would imagine it's more of a challenge to figure out where does it start and where does it end.
Yeah, like if you were like, who goes for like a complete DOS collection? Like, could you imagine that? It's like,
yeah, I mean, you might find a sub like I want all the gold box TSR.
Yeah,
games.
You
like,
know,
that some things make sense, but my God, you would never. Yeah, yeah. There's no end to it, and the 2600 is interesting because there is an end. There's a finite number of games. And when something like Air Raid surfaces, it's like, wow, there's plus one. Mm-hmm, and if I'm the guy that thinks I had the most, now I'm part of that market that wants that game and is willing to pay $11,000.
It's a constant game of moving the goalposts, which I mean, makes it interesting for the people in it. You know,
it is.
It's different than, like, you know, the Super Nintendo or something like that, where you say, like, there's 700-something games, and that's it. That's all there ever has been.
But then they find prototypes, though.
Yeah, but, you know.
All right. I think that was more than show and tell, which is good because we're a little light on this month's topics.
Greg from the Digital Press podcast. I'm here with the angry video game nerd, James Rolfe. We are at the Chiller Convention in Parsippany in October. James, first of all, thank you for taking the time out. Have you ever been to Chiller before? It's been going on a while.
Yeah, I've been here. I've been going here for about 10 years now.
Really?
Not every year, but the first time I came here was like 2003, something like that. Yeah. It's a big con, and it's twice a year.
Yeah.
Right in the New York City area, kind of. So.
So, still doing the Angry Video Game Nerd episodes.
Mm-hmm.
How do you feel about keeping doing that for a while? And
I had no idea it would go this long, but it did. I mean, because when I first did it, there was a long list of games I wanted to do, and it just never ended. And it was like, oh, I got to keep it going, And now it's a little different because it's 114 episodes? I'm starting to lose count now. So, you know, it's still always fun. It's like if I take it... as long as I don't burn out, go too fast with them, let the ideas come natural, play some games.
And you're doing games, you're doing movies, board games. I mean, the Sharknado thing was hilarious.
Yeah, I mean, that wasn't even on purpose that Sharknado came out. I wanted to do top 40 shitty shark movies, and then, what do you know, Sharknado, Ghost Shark, they keep coming.
Well, all the shark movies. You didn't really have to do anything. You just showed the shark
I know.
Movies. They're terrible.
Yeah. Yeah, there was a video that made itself. I didn't have to do... Yeah, there's very little you need to do with those.
So, the movie, I know you're still hard at work on it.
How's it going?
How's it going? Want to pull your hair out?
Yeah, definitely. I had no idea it would take this long.
Yeah.
So...
Did you bite off more than you could chew?
Yeah, definitely. It was just... it's just really complicated. Like, it's a very ambitious film, But I think when people see it, you'll know, you'll see it and be like, oh wow, they did this and they did that, and you know, there's a lot of ingenuity in it. It kind of went for like a summer blockbuster action movie, except that it's an independent film.
Yeah.
But it's really entertaining. It's absurd as hell, but it's entertaining.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you also have the video game.
Yeah.
Came out.
AVGN Adventures.
Yeah.
Yeah. It brings you back to those classic 8-bit days of frustration. It's hard.
Oh, really?
Oh,
listen, be a dad.
Oh, a dad. How's it feel to be a dad?
I mean, you're doing all this and you're a dad.
Yeah.
So, like, you're a superhero.
Yeah. I'd be Iron Man if I could.
How are you awake right now?
No. I don't know. I'm running on very little sleep all the time.
Okay, so today, when you go around the convention, who do you definitely want to see today that you know is here?
There's a lot. It's a huge guest list, really. I mean, to pick one, I mean, I know Weird Al's at the top of the page. I mean, I've always been a Weird Al fan.
Yeah, we've met him before. He's great.
Yeah, he's a cool guy. I never met him personally, but I've been to his shows. He puts on one of the best shows ever. Changes costumes after every song.
And he's not expensive, so
no,
believe it or not. Yeah.
Yeah.
So.
But there's a lot of people here, though.
Good.
Yeah.
So, thanks for being on the Digital Press Podcast.
Sure, yeah.
And good luck on the movie. I hope it comes out soon. And
maybe I'll come
you have
back to the store one day again. So
yeah. Well, if you do, you have to have a little notice because the last time it was a little crazy.
Okay.
So, thanks for coming on.
Okay. All right. Thanks, guys.
A lot, James.
Okay.
Appreciate it.
And we're back.
We're back.
Multi-platform games.
Ah, yes. So what we're going to talk about here is over the many years of video gaming. There have been games that have been made over across multiple platforms at the same time, basically. And the question is, the discussion will be, you know, which one was better? You know, as a kid, did you have to get one over the other? Now, as you're collecting, are you forced to buy them all?
It was always a...
What's the deal?
It was always a kind of a rat race where everybody had, you know, you saw this array of games and everybody was like, was in this rush to get the one that was the best. Which one had the best graphics? Which one was closest to the arcade version? You know, and nowadays it's not like that. But back then, you know, every console was completely different practically. Like every port of like Q-Bert or Donkey Kong, like they were sort of the same game. They were basically the same game, but they were vastly different.
Well, unless it was an Activision game, then they were exactly the same. For every system. Except I think in television. In television, for some reason, Activision seemed like they were forced to make the games they looked a little bit different than some of the other ones, but they were almost all the same.
I think it was more when it came to arcade ports. You know, like with something like Donkey Kong, Q-Bert. Like everyone wanted the one that was closest to what they saw at the arcade.
Yeah. Did you want to play the arcade
exactly.
game?
Yeah. So there was always like, you know, you see screenshot comparisons, like something like Pac-Man, you know, it's like, you know, this is their Pac-Man, this is ours, this is their Donkey Kong, this is ours. Yeah.
So, my view from a collecting perspective, here's an example here I have. This is Q-Bert Parker Brothers for the 5200 here, and then we have the Intellivision version here. Now, obviously, the difference being the color of the box, but if you were to look at the back here, I mean, you guys, the graphics are almost exactly identical. Mm-hmm. You know, there's very little difference, and the instruction manuals were always the same. Parker Brothers, same stupid manual for all the games, and this one's sealed. But anyway, I mean, they all pretty much had, you know, this kind of a design of the cartridge and the label like that, and etc. So as a collector now, since I actually have most of these systems, and then you go to collect for them, and you're like, I mean, most of these games, the multi-platform games, are cheap because they made a billion of them. But it's like, well, if you only have so much room to store your games or something like that, unless you're really looking to collect the entire library of a system, I'm always like, All right, well, let's say I have Qbert for ColecoVision. I'm like, well, do I need it for the 5200? Do I need it for the 2600? It's the same game. And so
upgrading. Like, you got to, like, a game for, like, the 2600,
right.
And then you got the new systems.
That's,
you know.
But see, that's another thing. See, back then, in the second generation, you collecting now, you have a choice. ColecoVision, Intellivision, 5200, very similar graphically. And so you don't lose much when you go from one game to the other. But 2600 looks a lot worse.
Yeah.
But so that's something I'm always battling is like, well, if I only get the game on one system as a collector, then I'll be able to get the more exclusive titles for each system. And then I could say, well, hey, I have I have this game on all these systems, have more of a variety, let's say.
Well, were there any situations where you had a game on the 2600 and then you had to have it on the Intellivision or the ColecoVision or something like that?
I mean, if you were to compare 2600, there's plenty of games that I have that I also have it on. Normally, I don't care as much if I have 2600 and one of the other ones because they're more, you know, they look better, they're more of an upgrade, let's say. But there's some where I have, and I'm like, you know, there's a couple I have both. Like, mine are 2049er, I have ColecoVision and 5200, because they look the same, but they're very different. They play very, very differently.
Well, it looks like, if you look at the screenshots here, it looks like the pyramid is wider on the 5200 than it is on the Intellivision. It looks taller.
It may have just been the 5200, I don't want to say the resolution, but the sprites and everything on there are bigger.
Yeah, it definitely looks like.
Compared to like Intellivision or ColecoVision, everything's kind of expanded.
Yeah, and the screen, the score is a little bit different. So it looks like graphically it is kind of different.
The controller also mattered too.
Yeah.
Like, you know, especially this generation, when half the controllers were terrible.
Well, I'll give the other, you know, caveat that I have is that I also have many of the flash cards these days, so if I don't have a game, that's what I'm saying, I don't really need the game for every system because I can just play it on one of the flash cards. So from Crazy Collector here, that's kind of where I stand in terms of, from a collecting point of view. But let's fast forward it a couple of generations, like as we're growing up now, and kind of became some differences now in some of these games. Like, you got this one here,
Mortal Kombat.
Yeah.
This is one of
those.
This is probably one of the most like well known examples of, the game comes out on multiple systems, and it was war at that point.
Yeah.
It was like, you know, Super Nintendo versus Genesis, and we all know how that turned out.
Yeah, versus Sega CD versus Game Boy. Actually.
Yeah. That was a common thing at the time.
Did you just say versus Game Boy?
Yeah.
Yeah.
No.
It came out on Game Boy all on the same day.
That was a common thing at the time. There were always, every game practically had like five versions. We got Nintendo, Super Nintendo, Genesis, Game Boy, and Game Gear. I distinctly remember that was a common thing.
Yeah.
You know, and usually the handheld versions were like either pared down seriously, or just like, you know,
they're barely playable.
Yeah, or like sometimes completely different games, but they always had like the same box art.
Yeah,
you know, it was a set, you know, and it was always, you know, that's when, you know, yeah, the, you know, especially when it became big with like the Super Nintendo versus Genesis.
Right.
That was the biggest one. Like that was like sort of like the real version of the game.
Yeah.
And then everybody, you know, it's like if you didn't have those, then you had to settle for one of the others. You know. Like, remember.
Do you remember when Madden came out? John Madden Football came out, and it was on the Genesis first, maybe by a year. It wasn't that long, but I gotta tell you, as a kid, everybody that could buy a Genesis, you were buying it for Madden.
Right.
Well, I mean, all the sports games, all the EA titles were significantly better on the Genesis.
Yeah, they just ran faster.
Yeah, yeah.
But the super blast process.
Yeah, well. I mean, I remember hockey, you know, all like the NHL PA, I think NHL PA 93 or something like that. It's like, I can't remember exactly which one I was playing. I played on both systems, but I remember playing Super Nintendo. Like, this is garbage. It's like it really felt like a serious downgrade.
One of the reasons I think was the music. I personally, maybe we'll get some reader mail for saying this, but I prefer the Super Nintendo music to the Genesis, personally. But for sports games, I've always felt like the Genesis music was a lot better because it could do those like hokey like organ sounds, yeah. Like dun 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 dun, yep. Dun, you know.
You're getting good beats, like it was like, yeah. Like the synthesized beat.
Well, the Genesis right. Was good for techno soundtracks like that. Yeah.
Well, I mean, you know, I might be the wrong person to talk about this, because one of my favorite hockey games is Blades of Steel on the NES. you get the penalty for losing the fight. You know, that's how hockey should be.
Well, yeah, so... All right, so Mortal Kombat, one of the big things with Mortal Kombat was there was a bit of a... you know, when it came out in the arcade, obviously, this was one of the first games that all the parents' groups came out to... Oh my God, you cannot have this game out and all this blood and fighting and gore and oh. And again, when it came out on the Genesis, mm-hmm. I think first, it had the blood. And then when they ported it to the Super Nintendo, they had to replace the blood with green.
It was gray. It was like gray sweat that was coming out.
Yeah, well, Nintendo was family-friendly.
No.
But you did have to use a code to get the blood in the Genesis version.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, you did. Oh, yeah. It wasn't automatic.
Yeah, it wasn't
automatic. Everyone remembers ABACABB.
Yeah, yeah. Abacadab.
Abacadab.
Yeah. But wait,
that wasn't even the only difference, though.
No.
Both ports were developed with different philosophies. Like, the Genesis changed the visuals and the music a lot.
Well, different developers.
Yeah. Yeah, like Probe, I think, did one.
They did the Genesis, and Acclaim did Super Nintendo.
What they did on the Genesis, they pared down the graphics, they pared down the sound, but they tried to keep the mechanics of the game, the way the game feels, as close as possible. And it worked out pretty good. The Super Nintendo tried to keep the visuals similar, but the game plays like garbage. It really does.
Actually,
it actually plays like garbage.
I would say the Super Nintendo one plays closer to what the arcade game feels like. Because, I mean, I'm playing on my main cabinet. Yeah. And I'm going to qualify that. But on my main cabinet, when I'm playing Mortal Kombat, it feels more like it does on the Super Nintendo, where there's like a slight delay to your movements. Whereas the Genesis version, which controls better, it's like it moves, you know, there's immediate movement. And it does play better with it, especially with the six-button controller. But... You know,
well, actually, I don't think that supported the six-button controller in the Genesis.
It did. The X button on the top would be your high punch, and the A button would be low punch.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
I remember that because I played that game so many times on my Genesis.
I didn't get a six-button controller until like after the Genesis died.
I was one of the cool kids.
Yeah.
But it was a third-party, you know, controller. It wasn't Sega's six-button controller, it still worked.
Right, so, you know, so the differences weren't huge in the 16-bit era, let's say, but that was kind of, for us, I mean, for our age group, it was like a surprise to see that, what is this cross-platform? I mean, we didn't, you know, growing up, but we didn't really, like, most of us either maybe had a 2600 or a ColecoVision, a lot of people didn't have both or something like that, so we weren't really used to that, and then... When NES came in, and you know, if you had a Master System, let's say, or God forbid, a 7800, you're one of those unfortunate kids. There really wasn't cross. I mean, there were some cross.
The NES and the 7800 had a few cross games.
Yeah, but
the Galaga, I think, on both.
Yeah, but but there was also Double Dragon.
Yeah,
they're terrible in the Atari version. But for the most part, it wasn't something that you would see a lot. And then, you know...
Wait, I'm sorry. I hate to be off camera. Are you on crack?
What?
Cross-platforming wasn't popular in the second generation? Dude, Frogger and Pac-Man and Ms. Pac-Man and Murder Time. No, but you're saying it wasn't that common back then, and then it became common.
No, I'm saying that, like, from our age group, we only may have had one system.
Oh, your age group's after the Atari. That's what I keep forgetting.
I know.
All right.
So I'm saying, like,
you just got schooled.
Never. I'm saying, like, we kind of inherited, most of us inherited a 2600, and so that's what we had. So we couldn't go out and say, I remember going to Toys R Us and seeing the Intellivision and looking at it and... Like, wait a minute, why do these games look better than my Atari versions? What the hell? But I was stuck, I couldn't buy them. And then when, by 16-bit, then this was actually, like, I remember, like, being, like, pressured and just like, Which one do I get?
Well, you know what happened.
Do I get the Genesis, and now I'm going to be stuck with the Genesis, and the Super Nintendo's going to have this...
Well, I think what ended up happening with the Genesis sort of was that system where when Genesis came out, it was sold on, these are like this is the arcade at home. You know, you want, like, I mean, it wasn't perfect, but Altered Beast was very close. I mean, you know, like, it was pretty close. I mean, at least for the time.
Right.
So that was sort of a big thing. Then when all of a sudden when the Super Nintendo came out, it became where some publishers started to get savvy. Rather than giving both systems the same game and having one be a little better than the other, they started giving sort of the same game, but not quite. So you'd have, like, sister games. Like,
Konami did that
a lot. Like, you'd have, you know, each game Turtles in Time, Ninja Turtles in Time on the Super Nintendo, and then you have, like, Hyperstone Heist, which is really the Genesis sister game.
It catered to each system's weaknesses and strengths.
Yep, Ninja Turtle Tournament Fighters was a different game, completely different game on all
the same names.
Aladdin is another game.
Different developers.
Yeah. Different
license
holders. But, you know, it was the same title. You know, like, you didn't know at the time, you know?
Right. No, it's Aladdin.
The Mega Man Game Boy games, you know, they were all still Mega Man 2, Mega Man 3, Mega Man 4, but they were different from the NES versions. Like,
they had to be.
Yeah. You know, they weren't, but what I mean is they weren't just, like, Game Boy versions of the NES game. They were different games,
right.
even though they had the same titles,
individual
at least here.
Well, that was a reason to buy it. Like, Nintendo was great at that. I mean, Metroid 2, I should say, and it's one of my favorite ever games. Mm-hmm. And that wasn't exactly like the NES version.
Yeah.
I mean, it was different. They had to make them. I mean, all the Super Mario Land games were vastly different. Different bosses, different level designs.
Yeah. It's like they played on the fact that, you know, if you had an NES, you had all these, like, staples. And then, but, you know, if you had a Game Boy, they would give you sort of the same staples, but just different versions that weren't crappier. They were just different. As opposed, you know, they got savvy about, we're not going to give the good version and the crappy version. You know, we're going to give the good version and the different
version.
Now
you have to buy all versions.
Yeah. You know? I mean, then you got, like, I mean, you always had things, sometimes they would have, like, you know, Tetris, they were pretty much the same game, just no color, Dr. Mario, same idea, you know. But for the most part, they sort of played up the strengths of each machine.
Yeah. So, all right, so now we got a little bit further, 32-bit. Let's look at this example here. I think this is a good example.
Die Hard Trilogy.
Die Hard Trilogy.
This came out on the PlayStation and the Saturn, right?
Yes.
That was it, right?
And PC.
Also a PC version. And I can go into all the technical differences because I know them all, but really the reason I would say I prefer the Saturn version is because the middle game, Die Hard 2, actually supports the gun on the Saturn. So you can play this with the stunner.
Mm-hmm.
And that makes all the difference in the world to me. And even the third game, I find runs better on the Saturn for some odd reason. The only game I would play on the PlayStation version that I would say is definitely better is the first one, where it's the third-person shooter where you're playing as McLean. That's the one I would say is definitively better on the PlayStation version. But for me, Saturn. That stunner. And this game, because it's just so over the top, buddy. Keep shooting them while they're down. It's ridiculous.
The Saturn and PlayStation had its own kind of, like, mini war going.
Oh,
but,
yeah,
you know,
big time.
But
by this time, it was clear who the winner was going to
be,
though.
But the thing is, I mean, it depends on which direction you were coming from. Because, you know, Saturn and PlayStation both had, like, you know, Capcom was supporting Mega Man 8, Mega Man X 4, and both.
Yeah.
But there was Mega Man 8 was a little better on the Saturn. It had a little bit extra stuff, and, you know.
Right, 2D was better on the Saturn.
But then you had, like, you know, if you were a fighting game fan, of course you were playing your fighting games on the Saturn, you know, whether they came out in the U.S. or not, because they were arcade perfect.
Well, that's the thing, is that Sega continued that arcade in your house philosophy, and, you know, you say they nailed it with the Genesis, I'd say they nailed it even better with the Saturn.
Of course, you know.
Yeah, and those were even closer to the original arcades, like Virtual Fighter 2, Virtual Cop.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they also had, the Saturn had the compilations, which... many of which were arcade ROMs, basically, like Afterburner. And,
yeah, practically.
Yeah. Yeah, the Sega Ages collection.
Had some, you know, they had some defects in them. But.
Yeah.
Now, one of the interesting things about, let's say, Die Hard, for instance, in that era, back in the 90s, for me personally, I got a PC. You know, we had terrible, like, hand-me-down, junky, former office PCs.
Gateway 2000s.
No, nothing like that. This was like IBM 8086s and 386s. You couldn't play anything on them. Terrible.
Windows 3.1?
Yes, yep, Windows 3 with like no disk space. Yep. Terrible. So eventually, I think I got a, it was either a 486 or maybe it was a Pentium. I can't remember. I think it was a Pentium. And somewhere around like 95. And, you know, I had the choice. At the time, I could have asked for another video game system. But I wanted a computer. I mean, the internet was becoming big at the time. The infamous AOL.
Yep. You got
Didn't
we just talk about that?
Yeah, we
either a video game
it.
System or get a computer.
So that was the thing. So I said, I want a computer. And I got the computer. And what was happening, and obviously this happened also in the 80s, but what was happening was that a lot of these titles, like on, say on the PlayStation, the Saturn, were on PC. And so I never really had the inclination to get a PlayStation. A lot of my friends had them, and I was like, well, they look better on the PC.
There were DOS ports, too, of a lot of games. I know Mortal Kombat 1 had DOS ports.
Mortal Kombat 2 had a DOS port. Mortal Kombat 3. Even Virtual Fighter had a PC port.
Yeah.
Two different ones, I think.
It's funny back then, too, with the DOS ports of games, because they always used to assume that you only had, like, a flight stick with one button. So, or something like that. So, like, the instruction manual would talk about, like, it's like, well, if you don't have a control pad, you can only punch or something like that.
I remember when this came out, somewhere around 93, Gravis came out with the first dog bone gamepad for the PC. I think they were the first ones that ever made that, was Gravis.
Everyone had a Gravis pad.
Was that the one with the little joystick that you could screw in?
Yes.
Yeah, I remember
Gravis gamepad.
Yeah. Oh,
and
it
plugged
awesome.
Into the MIDI port of the Mac.
Well, it was a game port.
Well, it was MIDI / game port. It was both.
Not in my house.
No, I didn't have any MIDI devices either.
So then it was a game port.
That was a godsend. Oh my god, a gamepad! I don't use it.
Yeah, I got four buttons. I can actually.
I
can punch and kick.
I got mine at the flea market.
So I wound up PC gaming during a lot of that period of time because the games look better. Now here's the irony. I don't even have most of those PC games anymore. I'm gonna get rid of them. I've kept like a lot of the Star Wars stuff because they were exclusive, unique.
Right.
Doom, maybe.
And now I have all PlayStation games. So I've evolved. I was on one platform, dumped that, and now I'm on the other platform.
You've regressed.
I guess so. It's more fun to collect like play the console games than it is to collect PC games.
Well, you can't really collect PC games anymore.
Why not?
Steam.
No, I mean the old stuff.
Sure, the old stuff, but I'm talking about modern day collecting on the PC.
True.
And even if you do get a retail game, it's a Steam key.
Right. It's just a box.
Yeah, exactly. You get a disc, but then when it's activated, you have to go on
Steam.
That
was the nice thing about old computer games, too. It's like the little tiny box. Disc, big fucking box. It's like all empty PC. Air, you know?
Yeah, it was a lot of empty air.
Why did they do that?
To protect the disc.
Yeah. Oh, I never understood that.
I think it was just like to take up the shelf space. Well, think about it though. If you go back, like I remember in the 90s, you went into like a Toys R Us or something, and obviously the game, you didn't pick up the game box. They had the little, what was it called? The video cards or whatever they were that you would just look, you could see the back of the front,
right.
And you'd take the ticket, there's my ticket, where's my game? So you would do that. So they had piles of games in the back room you never saw. Well, when you went to like the computer stores at that point, I mean, they probably had extra stock or whatever, but you could just go right up, pick up the game, you could look at the front of the box, the back of the box, there's some back there, but and you walked out with the game. So I think they kind of knew that the computer stores would not put a ton of them out there. Mm-hmm. So they couldn't like hog up the shelf space or competing for the shelf space or figure we're gonna make this box gigantic, and force it. Plus, a lot of the games that I had were simulations, and they had huge, ridiculous, like novel sized manuals.
Flight Sim was like that, right?
You needed the box. Simulator.
I had one Falcon 3.0. It was like 7 CDs and 10 manuals, and they were all novels.
Yes. So that was it.
But yeah, going back to like a multi-platform thing, I specifically remember, this is, getting into, you know, more like, you know, our type of group, you know, less, you know, more dedicated people. But you started seeing when systems like Jaguar came out and stuff like that.
Right.
You would see like something like Rayman. You know, you have it like the Jaguar version.
Yeah.
Then you have like the PlayStation 4. I think like because
the 3DO.
Yeah, the 3DO. And everybody at that point, the big thing was about which version was the original that they made it on, and which ones was a port. Because I specifically remember this happened with Earthworm Jim.
Right.
Like, everyone liked it on the Genesis. That's where they it started on the Genesis, and
right.
then it was like enhanced for the Sega CD.
Yeah.
But then it was ported to the Super Nintendo. It was a little crappier.
Yeah.
Mickey Mania, same way. So when it came to when you came to those types of games like you know Mickey Mania or like Rayman, everyone was interested in the like sort of like the base system.
Right.
I don't know if it was like that before. You know, when every console sort of had was its own sort of thing.
Right.
You didn't really. Look at like you looked at which one was closest to the arcade, or
right.
which one was just the best.
Yeah, which did they
you
develop
know?
On?
Yeah, now, but that when that started, it was like which one did they start developing?
Yeah,
because you sort of became savvy to the fact that the one that was sort of the base console was the best one, and all the ports were sort of downgraded
yeah.
in some capacity.
Well, I think one of the reasons the Sega CD kind of failed was that most of the a lot of the library was either. Really, really bad PC ports with, you know, the FMV stuff. But a lot of it was like you said, it was games that were already out on the Genesis. And, you know, you buy it for the Sega CD and you're like, well, I'm not gaining a lot.
It's
just a different soundtrack.
I'll say this. I think there are plenty of great Sega CD games that I love. Super Shark. I swear by that. But One of the biggest disappointments was on that system was Mortal Kombat, because you know I was suckered in, I think, by the marketing.
It was no better.
Yeah, and it was slightly enhanced from the Genesis version, but it was still effectively the Genesis version.
Well,
and I was all geared up, like this is gonna be like the arcade. And when I looked at it, I'm like, you know, it's better, but it's not better enough.
Well,
like, I feel like I was disappointed.
It had better animation.
Yeah.
Like, it's very close to the arcade in terms of animation. The color palette wasn't better,
yeah.
but the sound effects were arcade perfect, and the music was arcade perfect.
Just the thing. See, at the time, I wasn't really savvy enough to realize that the Sega CD didn't improve the Genesis that much.
Right.
You know, like, the things that really mattered
right.
that I would want to see that it couldn't do.
A 32X version
yeah.
probably would have done it.
Yes.
Yeah.
But even then,
yeah.
even the 32X versions of certain games, Mortal Kombat 2 has problems.
It does,
you know?
But in terms of colors, it's
yeah.
it's better than the Genesis.
But it's yeah, the 32X Mortal Kombat 2 is almost comparable with the Super Nintendo version. So, all right, so let's fast forward then to the Dreamcast... GameCube, PS2, Xbox generation, where all of a sudden, all of these comparisons that we're making,
yeah.
well, this is graphically better than this, and this is graphically...
Sort of became moves.
Gone! I mean, it's literally was the same
yeah.
game.
It might have been a thing if you had a high-def TV, you know,
yeah.
like a progressive scan, was like which system supported
yeah,
progressive
nobody,
scan?
Nobody had
like,
that.
Yeah. Like I think, like I remember, Soul Calibur 2 supported 720p on the Xbox, but it wasn't.
No,
yeah, it did.
480p.
No, on the Xbox version of Soul Calibur 2 was 720p. You couldn't play it widescreen. It
right.
was pillar box. It was like, you know, 4x3.
Right,
because but
Xbox,
it supported high
yeah,
definition.
It wasn't an anamorphic thing for some reason, but well, in most cases, the original Xbox games were the best looking ones, but only by small margins.
Yeah, it was somewhat
yeah.
manageable.
Because the PS2 was. The base at the time,
mm-hmm.
so you really, you had to go for the exclusives.
That was it. I mean, there were some exclusives. When I got the Xbox, when I chose the Xbox at the time, I said, I'm going to get a new system, I got the Xbox. There were exclusives that made me get it, you know, Halo
yeah,
and Project
right.
Gotham, but I thought that a lot of the other games just looked better on it, you know, the ones that were...
Some might have had slightly better textures, but
games that were high end on the PC
yeah.
were a lot better on the Xbox
mm-hmm.
than they were on the other consoles.
Yeah.
Like Max Payne 2 is
mm-hmm.
a good example. The PS2 version of Max Payne 2 has a lot of frame rate issues.
Mm-hmm.
Textures are washed out. You know, and the original Xbox version, console wise, was definitely
yeah.
the way to go.
Now I do the same thing with that generation in terms of collecting. Where I try to, I just try to get one version. There's no reason to get all these versions. Now, one of the differences in the versions would be little like hidden things, like one PS2 version of this game would have this track that the other one did. It had this level.
Yeah, console exclusive stuff.
But it was very limited. Like, oh, this has this character and this one doesn't. Whatever. Right. It was very limited. Then when they got into, this is the last thing we'll do. When it got into the PS3 and the 360 type thing, even though the game was cross-platform, all of a sudden you had all this DRM, this DLC stuff that was totally exclusive to each one.
There was no difference otherwise. They were the same. It was the same game.
So I know, but there was a lot of it. The content was, you sit there and be like, oh,
no,
man,
it's annoying. It's extremely annoying.
I want that content. What the hell?
And that's the only way, I guess, that the publishers felt that they could differentiate.
Yeah.
You know, they needed to do stuff like that, and it's annoying. It is.
I didn't like that.
There's no such thing as sort of like the definitive version. It's just
no.
Only in certain cases, like Ghostbusters was one that was a lot better on the 360 than it was on the PS3.
But then you could compare. I thought you were going to compare it to the Wii PS2 version, which was the.
I mean, not counting cartoonish versions that were developed in a different style, but there were a few exceptions. One was significantly better than the other. I think, at the time, Elder Scrolls 4, when it came out on the PS3, was a better version than the original.
Yeah, you'd have certain porting disasters, like Bayonetta or something like that.
Right.
But, you know. But generally speaking, for the most part, if things were done competently, there was no difference.
Yeah. And now, in this generation, we'll have even less of a
difference. Yeah, there's the same machine.
Yeah. With all minor differences.
Yeah. Alright, I guess we're
good. I got a quick...
Yeah.
If we can squeeze this in, I'll cut it if we don't. What is...
I'm closer.
The wrongest... No, what is the wrongest port you've seen? Or the worst, stupidest port?
Of a multi-platform game?
Yeah. Some port of something that was on multi-platform that just didn't belong
anything,
in a certain place.
There were a couple of games that were, I guess you could say, cross-platform. For some reason, they had the license. But the friggin' GameCom.
Yes.
Had some of the Sega arcade licenses. Yeah. So I was like,
yes.
What the hell is this shit?
It's like, Mortal Kombat 3 and the R Zone. R Zone. Yes.
It's like
you get this one eye. One eye.
Because that was the thing. It wasn't like when the Game Boy would have its version, totally different version for the Game Boy. It'd go crazy. The R Zone and the GameCom versions, they were trying to make them look like the N64. It's terrible.
I don't know if you consider this a port in the traditional sense because it came out so much later. But Mortal Kombat Advance on the Game Boy Advance was effectively Ultimate Mortal Kombat 3.
Yeah.
And it was it's
terrible.
No, it's like pre-alpha build. It's like you can't move. It's like you hit the button, nothing happens. Like you get hit, So the AI will just stand there sometimes, not do anything, and then sometimes it'll just like attack you, like go like hog wild on your ass, and, like it's a disaster.
Here's another one: Mortal Kombat 1 on the Master System.
There was a Master System port to that.
There was, and it
was it official. Was it like Brazil or something?
I think it came out in Europe and Brazil. I've never personally played it. I've seen videos of it, and it basically looks like a slideshow.
Yeah.
Well, I've seen unlicensed versions for the NES. Yeah. Were like in China. Remember the China?
Oh, of course,
Kept porting all the 16-bit stuff to the NES. Yep. Which it'd have like four colors and it was a lot of Disney stuff.
Yeah.
Terrible. So that was all. Those were horrible, horrible ports.
Well, ones that just didn't function properly, you know.
Except for one, we mentioned Aladdin. Apparently, there was an Aladdin port onto the NES or Lion King that was supposedly good. That was one of those unlicensed turds.
So on that happy note, we'll see you next time.